Hi, let's talk about the intrinsic laryngeal muscles. In this video, we'll discuss the major intrinsic laryngeal muscles and explain how their actions affect the vocal folds and or phonation. And by that, I mean how they adjust pitch and timbre. So the intrinsic laryngeal muscles connect elements of the laryngoskeleton to other elements of the laryngoskeleton. We can contrast them with extrinsic laryngeal muscles, which connect outside structures to the larynx. For instance, the longitudinal muscles that we discussed in the context of the pharynx are examples of extrinsic laryngeal muscles. Intrinsic laryngeal muscles are going to affect one of two things, either the position of the vocal ligaments, and by the ligaments I also mean the folds, or the tension on the vocal ligaments and folds. In terms of position, the muscles may either abduct, that's abduct, or adduct, or adduct. Abducted folds lead to a larger rima glottidis, whereas adducted folds lead to a narrower rima glottidis. In terms of tension, it's probably best to just understand that tension is proportional to pitch or frequency. So the greater the tension, the higher the pitch. The lower the tension, the lower the pitch. So let's take a look at some of these muscles. And let's start with my favorite, the posterior crico-arytenoid muscles. The names of these muscles reflect their attachment. So posterior cricoarytenoid muscles originate on the posterior aspect of the cricoid cartilage and insert on the muscular process of the arytenoid. When they contract, they pivot the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilage laterally. So they are abductors of the vocal folds. They open the rima glottidis, and this is maximally open for ventilation. These are the only muscles which do this. In addition, they slightly pull the arytenoid muscles posteriorly, and this is going to ever so slightly increase vocal ligament tension and pitch. These are innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerves. The transverse and oblique arytenoid muscles are named as a group because they sit atop one another. The transverse muscles fibers run transversely. As such, the oblique muscle fibers run obliquely. And they really attach arytenoid cartilage to arytenoid cartilage. The transverse arytenoid muscles, they are going to adduct the arytenoid cartilages and as such also the vocal ligaments. So they're closing the rima glottidis, which is the position for phonation. The oblique arytenoid muscles also do this, but they also have this extra airy epiglottic part, and this is within the airy epiglottic fold, which helps to serve as a sphincter for the laryngeal inlet. Both of these muscles are innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerves. We also have the lateral cricoarytenoid muscles. So think we had posterior cricoarytenoid muscles from the posterior aspect of the cricoid to the muscular process of the arytenoid. The lateral cricoarytenoid muscles originate on the lateral aspect of the cricoid and also go to that muscular process. So here we can see the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle going to that muscular process. And then here's the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle. So they're on opposite sides of that muscular process. When the lateral cricoarytenoid muscles contract, they are going to medially pivot the vocal process, thus adducting the vocal ligaments, thus closing the rima glottidis. So this is the position for phonation and then even whispering or even a modified valsalva maneuver. That's the sound that you make when you gird your insides, when you push air against your vocal fold. It's very protective for lifting. That's why people grunt when they lift. And these are innervated also by the recurrent laryngeal nerves. We also have the thyroarytenoid muscles. Thyroarytenoid muscles. These muscles run between the thyroid cartilage and the arytenoid cartilages. And when they contract, they protract the arytenoid cartilages. They move them forward, thus decreasing tension on the vocal ligaments, thus lowering pitch. There are specialized portions of these muscles. So for instance, immediately adjacent to the vocal ligament, specialized fibers of the thyroarytenoid muscles, known as the vocalis muscles, are going to pull on the vocal ligaments. And if you can imagine, this is a cross section of the vocal ligament. When those fibers pull on it, it increases lateral tension and it changes the shape of the vocal ligaments. So this can affect timbre or the tonal quality of sound, and it can also increase pitch ever so slightly. So it can finely adjust pitch. Whereas the main body of thyroarytenoid muscle decreases pitch, these vocalis muscles increase pitch. Finally, there's also a thyroepiglottic part. This thyroepiglottic part is between the thyroid cartilage and the epiglottis, as its name suggests. It ascends, and it is a dilator of the laryngeal inlet. It helps to pull that airy epiglottic fold slightly out of the way so as to let more air in. These are also all innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerves. And then finally, we have the cricothyroid muscle. Cricothyroid muscle runs between the thyroid cartilage and the cricoid cartilage. And when these contract, they tip the thyroid cartilage forward, thus putting tension on the vocal ligaments, because this is now further, thus increasing pitch. The cricothyroid muscle is unique among all of the intrinsic laryngeal muscles in that it is not innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. It is innervated by the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. So we've discussed the various intrinsic laryngeal muscles and their functions in terms of the rima glottidis, or tension on the vocal ligaments. This is your summary slide, and I thank you for your time.